In 1861, an Englishman named Billy Barker discovered a gold nugget just east of the Caribou Mountains here in British Columbia. And the day that he found that gold nugget, it set off what we call a gold rush. People came from all over in search of finding gold and striking it rich in those mountains in eastern BC. And almost overnight, that discovery of gold created a new town called, after Billy Barker, Barkerville. And within a few weeks, nearly 5,000 people had moved there, of which 3,000 were immigrants from China. So there were people coming from all over the world to find gold. And for a while, for a brief time, Barkerville was the place to be, where you could make a fortune prospecting and searching for gold to get rich. Boomtowns like Barkerville share one thing in common. Eventually, the thing that started the town, whether it's gold or silver or oil or diamonds or whatever it might be, eventually that thing runs out. And as soon as it runs out, so does the town. Today, Barkerville is a ghost town. Nobody lives there. It's just a tourist attraction that if you really want to see, you can drive 5 or 6 hours at least north to get there to have a look, right? There's no one living there. The town is no longer a town. But there is sort of still a sparkle or an allure or an attraction to the idea of what started Barkerville. Getting rich quick. Finding something that's going to make your life easy from here on out. And today we don't have gold rushes per se. People don't leave everything to go digging around for gold. But we still have that idea. Every time that Lotto Max gets up to the 60 million, the most that I think it can be, people rush out to buy lottery tickets in hopes of striking it rich, making millions overnight, and then feeling set, feeling like they can take life easy. It's easy to see the attraction to that, isn't it? You can dream of having a big house that looks out over the sea or on the mountains or in the downtown. You can dream of taking all the trips and vacations you want and sitting back and enjoying fine food and having a good and easy life. And there's a certain attraction to that, which is why people go and spend their money on lotto tickets. In a way, the miracle that we heard Jesus did last week, feeding the 5,000, had the same effect on the people that a gold rush or a lottery ticket might have on us. They saw Jesus feed a crowd of 5,000 men, plus the women and children, with just a few loaves of bread and 2 fish. And even after the whole crowd had eaten as much as they possibly could, there was still extra left over beyond that. And the people, they were pretty amazed. They thought to themselves, this is our lotto ticket. If this guy, Jesus, can make food for us here like this, imagine what else he could do. He could build all of us a great palace to live in, a great house that we could sit back and relax, provide all the food we need so we could sit back and take life easy, and he can be our bread king. Jesus, in fact, right after that story of feeding the 5,000, he actually had to take action. The people wanted to come and make him a king by force so he could be a bread king, so he had to leave. And even after Jesus left, the people didn't give up this idea. They actually got in boats and then sailed across the Lake of Galilee, the Sea of Galilee, in search of Jesus because they weren't ready to give up what they thought was a free lunch, a free meal ticket. And that's where we find ourselves at the beginning of what is called Jesus' sermon on the bread of life. The people are searching for him because they want him to do that feeding of the 5,000 again and again, all the time. Here's where we find Jesus saying in response. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, for on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Jesus is telling us in these verses exactly what's going on in the hearts of those people who enjoyed his free lunch. They weren't interested in Jesus. They weren't interested in what he had to say. They weren't interested in the miracle that he had performed as a sign from God. They were interested in more free food. They were interested in getting, like a gold rush or a lotto ticket, an easy life fast. And they thought Jesus can provide it. If we're honest with ourselves, there are times when we can do that too. When we want God to give us the things we need and we get in line with our prayers and start asking what I like to call gimme prayers. God, please give me more money. Give me a better job. Give me a bigger house or a bigger apartment. Give me a better life than I have. Give me a child or a dog or an RRSP or a pension plan that's robust so I can retire early. Give me all the things that I want and all the things that I need. And so our prayers go. They're easy to pray, aren't they? To think of all the things that we need or that we want and just say, "God, give me these things. That will make my life better." But like the crowd who was looking for Jesus for a free lunch and not to see the miracle and not to hear his words, when we do that, we betray ourselves to God, showing that we too, we're not interested in God, what he has to say. We're just interested in the free stuff that he might give us. And so that's why our prayers sound this way. And Jesus says, if that's the case, he has a warning for us. He says, "Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life." Now you know what he means here. If you've ever forgotten your sandwich in the refrigerator a few days too long, and then it comes out with green spots all over it. You open it and you smell that nasty, funky smell, and you realize this sandwich is no more, it just needs to be thrown in the green bin. And that happens to sandwiches. It happens to bananas. It happens to avocados and cucumbers and all the food that we might like to eat. If we don't eat it quickly enough, it spoils, it goes rotten. Unless it's a Twinkie or some gross food that isn't really food that can be preserved for years on end. In which case, you shouldn't eat that anyway. But anything that's good, you know it's going to go rotten if you don't eat it quickly enough. And Jesus says, if you put your ultimate hope and you find your joy and happiness in things like bananas or anything that can go rotten or be destroyed or lost or wrecked, that's not good. It's not good. Just look at Barkerville. It's a ghost town today. It only lasted for about a decade, and then it started to plummet into decay when people realized there was no more gold here and they left. They went to find something else, something better, something that would continue to give them the riches they wanted. When we put our ultimate hope in things that don't last, they don't last. They fail. They get lost. They get ruined, and our hopes are dashed. And even if we can find another thing to replace it, that thing's going to get ruined as well. And if at the end of our lives or on the last day, Jesus comes back and all we have done is put our hope in material things and food and things that don't last, we're going to be filled with an even greater regret than the regret you have that you didn't eat your sandwich fast enough, that you let it go rotten. So instead, Jesus urges you and I to put our hope, our trust, our joy in seeking food that won't spoil, spiritual food, the kind of food that he came to give us. They asked him, "What must we do to do the works God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness," just like we heard about in our lesson from Exodus, right? "As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, 'Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world.' 'Sir,' they said, 'always give us this bread.' Then Jesus declared, 'I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty.'" Jesus' response to this seeking of things that spoil, of food that spoils, is to not work for food at all, but rather to work for the food that God would give us. In other words, to believe in Jesus, which isn't work at all. The solution is not to look for something quick, something easy, something that's going to satisfy us here and now and make our lives comfortable, but to seek something that can't be taken away from us. To seek the kind of peace that no matter what circumstances in life come, we still have peace and joy before God. And this is what Jesus desperately wants us to have. It's the reason that he even came here to this earth. He wants to offer us a spiritual food, a spiritual drink, the kind of thing that once we have tasted of it, we realize we have a satisfaction that will last forever. Can you imagine eating a piece of bread and never feeling hungry again? Never being thirsty again? How would that change your life? But this is what Jesus has come to give us by giving his own life for us as a sacrifice on the cross. Maybe that seems too easy. In fact, someone said that to me this week. It seems too easy that Jesus could just die and in a matter of a few hours have solved the problem for the whole world for all time and taken away all sin. It just seems like that isn't enough, that there needs to be something more to it than that, more than we could imagine. And indeed, it was a lot more than we could imagine. The world is always chasing after things and stuff and food and pleasure, and those things, they never satisfy us. They always lead us craving for more. We want more money, or more food, or more time with our family, or more vacation time, or a bigger house, or a better car, or a newer phone, or whatever it might be. We're always craving, seeking the next thing. But the very fact that we crave should lead us to realize that there needs to be something that satisfies us. And all of those cravings point to the need for a full and complete kind of satisfaction that can only be something that isn't destroyed or lost. And this is what God was doing. It wasn't a quick and easy fix. It wasn't the kind of gold rush, get rich quick kind of plan to save us from our sins. No, God was planning from all eternity when he would make the world, and planning from all eternity how he would save the world in Christ. And if you read the Bible, the Old Testament, more than 1,000 pages, you recognize that all of that was God's plan, carrying out step by step how he would bring his son into the world, how God would send bread from heaven in Jesus at just the right time and in the right place. And how Jesus lived, not just a moment to die for us, but every moment of his life building up to the moment when he would give himself for you to be your spiritual food. That through faith in Jesus, in his death for you, and in his resurrection, God can give you the kind of peace, the kind of satisfaction that you can't find anywhere else in the world. But once you've tasted of it, once you understand what it means to have forgiveness given to you freely from God, once you have tasted of the peace that Jesus gives you with the Father, once you have been strengthened by the food that he gives you in his word, you recognize, at last, I have found it. Satisfaction in a true way that nothing in this world can take away. Even if you were literally starving to death, or if you hadn't eaten breakfast today and you were going to miss lunch and dinner as well, you could still be satisfied, recognizing the peace you have with God. You see, when we find Jesus, the true bread of life, in him we can be truly satisfied. And then we can recognize all the spiritual junk food that's out there. We can recognize that chasing after things like a gold rush or lotto tickets or a better stuff that we could have in our lives isn't the way to get satisfaction. But rather, we come to Jesus. We find that we already have everything we need to obtain eternal life through him. And in his peace, and in his forgiveness that he has given you, and in the gift of baptism by which he has washed you, as we saw just moments ago, you are satisfied. And the bread of life gives you spiritual food that is true satisfaction. Amen.